I can summarize what he said, a couple sentences. Quoting a poem, the lives of great men tell us that we too can be great, right? Second is that if you have the imagination, you can pick up the pieces of a broken masterpiece of a glass vessel and put them together, and they can become a greater masterpiece than even before. Now, let me take you back to this strain of thought that I've been developing over a period of time. In the last session, I said that questioning has much to do with the preservation, enhancement of life. All right? Now, today my focus will be not on preservation, because I've said something about it already, but on enhancement. It's not as though preservation is unimportant. For example, if you ask questions about where you will be, what kind of work you will do, whether you will earn your keep or not, whether you will have environments conducive to your survival, all these questions are important. And not only to ask these questions, but also to ask a further question as to what can I do about it and do something about it. So all these are important. But today, for want of time, I want you to think with me on the second part, which is the more difficult of the two. Okay? That's why I'm hoping to develop it. Now, the question of enhancement. What does it mean to enhance our life? Right? Okay? Now, I'm going to give a full lecture of maybe 90 minutes duration on the subject coming Saturday. If you are interested in developing this thought further, you're most welcome. It's at 4 o'clock Saturday in the hall. And today I will develop just a rudimentary thought with you, because that's all we have time for. Okay? Now, I want you to listen very carefully and think deeply with me. Very often people think that enhancement is a matter of merely receiving. Today I want to tell you that enhancement is more importantly a matter of responding. You understand? So there are two words that I used, receiving and responding. What's the difference between the two? One is a flow towards you, and the other is a flow out of you. Alright? Remember this? Very simple. I talk only about simple things, but simple things are the most challenging things in the world. Right? So now, as an illustration, let me take just one phenomenon from nature. I'm sure all of us have seen a river. Anyone sitting here who does not know what the river means? Anyone who has not seen a river? All of you have seen rivers, at least one river, right? Now I want to ask you a question. When you see a river, what are your feelings? How do you relate to that river, which is right in front of you, which you have seen several times, again and again? Maybe you've had a swim. Maybe you did like what I did when I was a small boy. I went in and swam in the river. And while once when I was trying to swim across the river, I nearly got drowned. Nearly. Not completely. Alright, otherwise you would have been better off. So, all of us have experienced the river, fine? I want to ask you, what did you think about it? And you might wonder how a river or a leaf or a flower or a blade of grass or a grasshopper can actually enrich your life. Now that's what I'm going to demonstrate to you. Okay, let's go. Now, what is a river? First of all, a river flows, right? There is no river which does not flow. That which does not flow is not a river. That's why Lord Buddha said, no one can step into the same river twice. Why? It's continuously moving. While you are standing, the river is changing. Why? Because it is flowing. Right? That's life. You are not the same person today that you were yesterday or day before. So there is a connection between you and the river, which I am going to further demonstrate and explain. Now, let us say that the river is flowing from the past through the present into the future. Because if there is a flow, there is a beginning, there is a midpoint or a reference point somewhere, and there is an end point, right? And let's say that all rivers end up in the ocean, right? Rivers are headed towards the ocean. So there is a flow which started somewhere, and in our mind, we associate that starting point with the past, though that past is also present, right? Now suppose the Ganga originates in the Gangotri, then Gangotri is not just in the past, it is still there. If the origin dries up, there will be no river. Okay? So it's also in the present. So that which seems to be the past is also present. Alright? Now, this river, the water in the river is flowing, and one day it will go and fall into the sea. Now, what is the sea? The sea, let us say, is the future. Okay? But is the sea only the future? Is not the sea also the past? Because it's been there for millennia. Right? So what is your future? Is there no connection between your future and your present, your future and your past? Don't you think that you're scripting your future today? Don't you think that what you did 5 years ago, 10 years ago, or what you did not do 5 years ago, 10 years ago, will influence your future? Of course it does. Never in a real way. That's why we said that each day's life must be lived with responsibility, with keenness, with eagerness and enthusiasm. Okay? Now, what is this river? Well, in a sense it is a flow, but it is also something in itself. This river has been there for quite a long time, hundreds of years, thousands of years. And in the process, it has added to itself a whole universe of experiences and memories. Maybe at the bottom of the river, you have sludge created by the decay of the billions of leaves that fell into the river. And over a period of time constituted that sludge, which is full of organic memory, I think. Maybe a little boy like me one day tried to swim across the river, didn't quite make it, and he went down. And maybe his life is in it. Maybe someday on the bank of the river, a heartbroken young lady, a girl perhaps jilted by her lover, came, sat and wept and wept and wept till her tears began to swell the waters. Maybe, how do you know? Maybe somebody violated a woman, killed her and dumped her body into the river, and she's part of this river. How do you know? It's a world. It's an entirely different world. All kinds of things are in it. Maybe one day a bride, all decked up, got onto a boat, She had to go to the other side because the groom was there and the wedding was to be celebrated there. And suddenly there was a squall. The wind blew and began to shake the boat. The boat swayed. It was a man of courage, determination. Everybody thought that this boat will sink or capsize and the bride will be drowned. But he fought the elements and he made it. And maybe the sweat of the heroism and the boatswain is also part of this river. How do you know? But when you look at this, that something is just flowing, a certain quantity of water is flowing from one direction to the other, and that's the end of it. That's your poverty. The enrichment comes when you ask the question, what is indeed this river? What is this river? And that is enrichment. If you don't ask such questions, you will simply be a passerby or an onlooker to all possibilities in life. I've taken the most familiar example from nature and hopefully demonstrated to you the richness that is awaiting to be looked at. It is right there. You don't have to go all over the continent looking for meanings. It is there. You can reach out and touch it. And that's called self-enhancing questions. And if our education does not enable us to ask such questions, one more point and I will stop. You know, there is a Malayalam song which talks about a river, like a river called Periyar. And I'll only just translate one line from that poem. It was written in the 60s. It says, "O you river, that like a village girl gets up early in the morning and dresses up properly," and there's a description of the way she dresses, "and she begins her journey, carrying on her head, as it were, a pot full of coolness." Have you seen village girls going to water sources, water bodies, drawing water, carrying it on their heads, balancing it without even touching? No, it's a beautiful sight. So it says, "carrying a pot full of coolness on your head, and you walk coyly your daily run, and in the course of your coy walk, you first visit a temple, a Hindu temple, and your next port of call is a Christian festival, and in the next step, you visit a Muslim mosque. Where are the labels that men have created? The river knows no such labels. A Hindu can swim, a Christian can swim, a Muslim can swim, provided he knows how to swim. The river knows only one distinction, and that distinction is, can you swim or can you not swim? That's it. And that's what life is. Everything else is a slur on life. Everything else is a lie. Everything is destructive of life. A river flows not just out there. The river is inside you. Let's rise and pray."